Good afternoon. Thank you all for being here, for taking the time out. We hope that we can give you something new, something to chew on, and leave you with more information about the culture of Afro-Colombians. I have the pleasure of introducing our honored group today, Explosión Negra, or Black Explosion. They are a group of Chocoanos, or people from Chocó in the Pacific Coast, which they'll tell you more about. They now live in Medellin, and they have formed a group using their music, using the Afro-Colombian music, different traditions that they learned as young people, and incorporating that and mixing that with contemporary music, such as rap. And they use that music to be social agents for change in Colombia for the different things that are going on. I think Solomon spoke a little bit about the displacement and other things that are going on in Colombia, especially with the Afro population there. So they're going to talk to you all about that, and also we hope that we can get you all up dancing. Any dancers?
Right here.
I think everyone here is a dancer, so at the end, we'll see. So hopefully we'll get you all up dancing, singing, but involved with the culture. This we hope for it to be more interactive as opposed to a lecture. So without further ado, presento a Explosión Negra.
Most of the guys in the group are from Chocó, which is a region on the Pacific coast of Colombia. And we'll talk a lot about the Pacific coast and how the music that we interpret relates not just to Africa, but to African American music and culture as well.
Ok, buenas tardes. ¿Cómo están?
Bien.
¿Entienden español?
Sí.
¿Un poquito? Ok, bueno. ¿Sí sabían que habemos afrodescendientes que hablamos español? ¿Sí sabían?
So we want to see a show of hands. How many people know that there are people of African descent who speak Spanish and not English?
Okay. Buenísimo. Bueno, pues no, primero que todo, pues muy contentos de estar aquí y queremos mostrarle un poquito de lo que es nuestra cultura, de nuestra música, nuestra herencia.
So first, we're really, really happy and honored to be here, and we'd like to share with you a little bit about the culture and heritage of the Pacific culture that we interpret and represent through music.
Bueno, comienzo por decirle que venimos, pues obviamente, de Colombia, ubicado en Sudamérica. Colombia es un país con más de 47 millones de habitantes. La población afrodescendiente representa más o menos el 11,6% de la población general.
So we're located in Colombia, South America. So we have some geographical context. Of the entire national population, the official count, which is in dispute, is that Afro-descended people represent something like 11 to 15% of the national population. And because of displacement from violence and other factors, that number is in dispute.
Bueno, la mayoría de la población afrodescendiente se ha ubicado desde sus inicios en las partes costas del país, específicamente el Pacífico colombiano, sacando departamentos como el Chocó, Valle del Cauca, Timbiquí y otras regiones donde está la mayoría de la población afrodescendiente.
So today the majority of the Afro-descendant population in Colombia is located on the two coasts, the Atlantic coast and also the Pacific coast. Particularly, we're concerned today, we're going to talk a lot about the Pacific coast, which is the department of Chocó, here in green, and that area is like 95% Afro-descendant.
Okay, bueno, ¿cómo llega la población afrodescendiente a Colombia? Pues nos remontamos hasta la diáspora, desde cuando los españoles quisieron traer mano de obra a América del Sur. Entonces vinieron los esclavos desde África para hacer trabajos como minería, trabajo de agricultura, trabajo doméstico.
So how did this Afro-descendant population get to Colombia? They weren't there to begin with. It was for slavery. And Colombia was occupied by Spain for a long time, and the slaves were brought initially to work in mining, in agriculture, and domestic jobs in people's homes.
La población afrodescendiente trajo consigo, los esclavos trajeron una gran riqueza cultural a Colombia, desde la música, la tradición oral, las diferentes manifestaciones, desde la gastronomía y toda clase de cosas que ayudaron para que la cultura colombiana tenga una identidad muy fuerte hoy en día.
This Afro-descendant population brought a lot of cultural richness to Colombia through music, through gastronomy, and we're going to obviously show some examples of those things, and the richness of that tradition carries through to today.
Bueno, mire, para lograr obviamente la abolición de la esclavitud fue un gran proceso, una gran lucha de resistencia durante muchos años. Los primeros podemos destacar como ejemplo a Pencos Biobó, uno de los primeros líderes reconocidos como en empezar la causa para lograr la abolición de la esclavitud.
Very much like what happened in the United States, the slavery era here in this country, we had a strong abolition movement in Colombia. One of the main leaders of that movement was a man called Bencos Biojo, that he's going to talk about now a little bit more. And that's...
Mencionaste el año de la abolición o todavía.
Okay, bueno, se empezaron a implementar una serie de métodos para lograr la abolición de la esclavitud, y bueno, todo parte del trabajo que inició Bencos Biojo cuando ayudó a escapar a otros esclavos de sus amos y se internaron en la selva para formar palenques.
So this man Bencos Biojo and other Afro-descendant leaders, there were many ways that the abolition movement was able to gain traction. And one of them was to form what's called palenques, which was a method to help slaves either basically escape from their owners and become part of a community that was called a palenque, basically a fort, a stronghold.
Sí, bueno, dentro de esos métodos estaban, por ejemplo, lo que hoy culturalmente hace parte de nuestra identidad, y es, por ejemplo, las trenzas que se hacen las mujeres. En su época ayudaron y sirvieron como mapas para ayudar a guiar a los esclavos que querían escapar de sus amos a los palenques.
So these palenques, their function back then was to basically create a defensive stronghold against the Spanish, because the Spanish kept coming back and trying to steal them back into slavery. So how do we maintain these palenques in a strong fashion? One of the ways that they used was through braids. They would go to the plantations and braid women's hair, and then and would bring maps into their hair. So these were ways to find these townships.
También la música jugó un factor muy importante en esa lucha por la abolición de la esclavitud. Las mujeres hacían cantos que habían traído desde África, en algunos llevaban códigos para guiar a algunos esclavos para poder escapar.
So music played a huge role in this abolition movement, and it carries the importance, the cultural importance of music carries through to today. One of the main ways to use music back then was to embed codes in the lyrics of songs, so that people would know, again, how to find the link.
Solo hasta 1851 se logró la abolición de la esclavitud, y a partir de ahí la población afrodescendiente empezó a vivir de una manera libre en Colombia. Claro que fue algo que durante los primeros años fue muy duro, porque se dictó una ley en la cual decía que solo podían ser libres hasta después de cumplir los 18 años, y si algún esclavo era hallado por ahí sin hacer nada, lo metían a la cárcel, y cualquiera amo podía pagar su libertad y tenía derecho a llevárselo a trabajar para él.
So after finally achieving abolition in 1851, the Colombian government passed a law basically freeing slaves. But the irony of that was you could have liberty or freedom, but only after you're 18 years old. Not only that, if you were found on the street, in other words homeless with no job, they could throw you in prison. And any slave owner could go to prison and buy, once again, one of these slaves. So it's like hitting you from the front and the back.
Okay. Bueno, la población afro se ha distribuido por diferentes regiones del país, pero especialmente están en las costas ribereñas del Pacífico colombiano, como les hablaba al principio, el Chocó, donde su vida ha girado en torno a la agricultura, trabajo de campo, la minería, y con el paso de los años muchos han venido emigrando hacia las grandes ciudades para desempeñarse en diferentes trabajos y profesiones.
So what happened after that abolition? So we had Afro-descendant populations in the two coasts, the Atlantic coast and the Pacific coast, beginning to form societies, beginning to form culture, a lot of which was based on the work they were doing as slaves, mining, agriculture, etc. Not only that, Harry's talking about some of the people in these regions were moving into the larger cities to gain, or are still today, they're moving into the larger cities for education, for better work opportunities.
El impacto que ha generado la cultura afrodescendiente ha sido muy fuerte en diferentes campos, la música, la gastronomía, el deporte, en lo político. Se han venido sentando precedentes muy fuertes, buscando aún estamos en esa época en la que estamos buscando más la inclusión como tal, porque la población está trabajando de manera separada en colectivos. Aún no hay una unión muy fuerte que logre generar un impacto muy grande en Colombia.
So now we're beginning to have icons emerge from the Afro-Colombian community. Emerge meaning we're seeing political figures, educational leaders, people in sports, music, entertainment, who are becoming not just Afro-Colombian leaders, but they're starting to become people who are visibly Colombian icons. We're sort of on that path. It's a lot like the early to mid-80s in the United States.
Okay, y bueno, para finalizar mi exposición, pues cabe resaltar que pues además de los diferentes campos en los que la población afro se destaca, la cultura, la música, el arte representa algo muy fuerte para no solo para los afrodescendientes, sino para Colombia como tal, porque esto ha marcado la identidad cultural de Colombia. Gran parte de la identidad de cómo se identifica Colombia es por el aporte que han hecho los afrodescendientes.
So one of the main methods for maintaining a cultural heritage is through the use of festivals. So we're beginning to gain more visibility for this community through festivals like This is the San Pacho Festival that takes place in the north of Choco, in a city called Quibdó, which is the capital. This is, again, another festival that represents not just the music, but the culture, but the dress, the food. And this is one of the instruments that's being used to, in some ways, rescue the stuff that's in danger of being lost.
Bueno, y como somos músicos artistas, vamos a introducirlo un poco en aquella, en toda esa música tradición que nos caracteriza. Mi compañero Jombi le va a hablar de eso.
So, Jombi, another one of our members of the band here, is going to talk specifically about one of the folklore music forms that we have in Choco. It's called Chirimía.
Okay. Hola, ¿cómo están? Bueno, ok, yo les voy a hablar de la chirimía. La chirimía es un formato instrumental del Pacífico Norte colombiano que se utiliza para animar las fiestas. Por ejemplo, San Pacho, que es una de las fiestas más grandes del departamento.
So it's important to note that there's a different musical feeling and cultural feeling between the north and the south of Choco, the Pacific region. Chirimía comes from the north, and it's a musical form that very much is used to like ignite the party. It's a very up-tempo, like, carnival-style music.
Okay, este formato instrumental es bueno, es importante porque es el motor, es el que da vida a las fiestas, es el que motiva a los jóvenes a salir a la calle. Es como, mejor dicho, como decimos en el Chocó, es el boom. Este formato instrumental es muy importante.
So, as I was saying before, it's really the spark, it's the motor of the parties, it brings people out to the streets. It's like, well, it's time to party.
Ok, bueno, yo les estoy hablando del asentamiento, en el asentamiento afro. En el asentamiento indígena, el formato chirimía es diferente. Porque ellos utilizan, pues, un tambor es parecido a un redoblante, que igualmente ahorita más adelante les vamos a mostrar un poquito. Pero bueno, ellos utilizan la chirimía más que todo para rendir homenaje a la madre tierra, a sus dioses.
So the musical form is used kind of in homage to Mother Earth in a way.
Okay, bueno, ahorita les voy a hablar de los ritmos más importantes que nacen de este formato instrumental. Tenemos el currulao, el abosao, el aguabajo, una jota, un pasillo. Estos ritmos nacen a través de nuestros abuelos, porque a través
de los ritmos.
Bueno, so you just listed a whole bunch of rhythms for you. Currulao, abosao. We're going to talk about each of these rhythms, so it's okay that we didn't go one by one. But he's just talking about some of the different rhythms that are used in the Pacific Coast, and we're going to show some examples of each one, what they look like, what they sound like, and also their function.
Okay, pues sí, así como les estaba comentando, son ritmos que nacen a través de nuestros abuelos, porque a través de esos ritmos ellos transmitían lo que pensaban fuera tristeza, alegría, eran pues como la sensación en el pueblo. Porque era algo pues que llamaba mucho la atención.
So these rhythms are used to either transmit emotions that are being felt in the town, but it's really important to know that it's part of the tradition, like of the ancestors. These are rhythms that come from Africa.
Bueno, ahorita yo les voy a hablar de los instrumentos básicos que se utilizan en la chirimía.
So we'll go through the instruments that are used in this musical form. Some of them will be really, really familiar to you, but they're interpreted differently in Afro-Colombian music.
Bueno, de ahí tenemos un par de platillos. Es como pueden observar, pues que es de lámina de zinc. Claro que en el Pacífico, pues lo organizan de una manera, pues, para que se sienta más típico para la chirimía.
So you see some hand symbols, we call them platillos, and it's again, you can tell it's going to be something you see in the marching bands, how hand symbols are used. It's kind of again igniting the party. Same thing in chirimía.
Ok, y aquí tenemos la tambora, que es el instrumento madre de la chirimía. Este es el que da el toque,
la base
principal para bueno, mejor dicho, desde estos instrumentos empiezan a nacer, de ahí ese es como el instrumento madre que nacen los ritmos.
So this is the base, this is the fundamental, like the backbone of the chirimía, la tambora. It's the drum that we have right here, and it's the foundation of the Chinyo.
Bueno, yo les voy a mostrar un poquito cómo suena.
So yeah, another horn. It's a tuba, right? So this is another one that complements the tambora, that gives a particular kind of emotional expression that you want in that form of chimio.
Okay, tenemos el redoblante, que es un instrumento también que se utiliza en la banda de marcha. Cabe decir también que en el Pacífico lo organizan para que se sienta más típico, más original, para que suene más a chimio.
So the snare drum is, están diciendo que varía mucho en cada juego, ¿cierto? Como tocan. So chimia, it depends from like town to town. This is one of the main instruments that will give it the variation from town to town, because there's a lot of individual interpretation in how they play the snare drum. It's the same thing when you see a marching band. The person who's playing the snare is going to do it. Everybody does it differently.
Bueno, aquí tenemos también el saxofón, que se complementa con el bombardino y con la tambora, que también ayuda a que se sienta. Pero aquí tenemos el maestro también que toca saxofón. Es un complemento más que hace que se sienta más lleno.
So another complementary element is the saxophone, another way to give it some unique flavor depending on who's playing and how they want it. It's a very, chimia is very improvisational, and it's something that obviously, when you're listening to it, you start to hear street jazz, New Orleans style, you hear highlight from Ghana, you hear all these elements that inform the chimia.
Okay, bueno, aquí ahorita le vamos a mostrar un video para que escuchen a ver cómo suena la chimia.
So we'll show you a little video that puts it all together, everything you've just seen. This is a...
Okay, bueno, ahorita lo tengo con la compañera Lima, que le va a hablar del Curulaco Pacífico Sur.
All right, so now we're going to hand it over to Dilma. Dilma is another one of our... Okay, so Dilma's going to talk about Curulaco, which is another rhythm, and this one is more closely tied to the southern region of the Pacific Coast. And I was saying earlier that there's a big variance in between north and south. The south in general tends to be more kind of mystical, spiritual, a lot closer to some of the older African traditions in terms of local religious beliefs, and it's reflected in the music. So we'll talk about Curulaco, which is...
Creo mostrar un poco de lo que ha tomado Explosión Negra como grupo musical para, de esa tradición musical que es chimia, para hacer una evolución de la música tradicional.
Okay, so before we get to the Curulaco, switch gears a little bit, we'll go back to this chimia, and we're going to show you guys what we as a musical group, how we interpret, evolve, rescue the sounds of the Chirimía in our music. So this is one of our music.
Bueno, ahorita vamos a hablar de alabados igualí.
So we're going to talk now about, before we get to Kurla, we're going to talk about alabados igualí. These are two musical forms from the Southern Pacific.
Bueno, el alabado se relaciona siempre a los ritmos, a una tradición oral religiosa que se hacen a los muertos.
So the alabao is a musical form that's traditionally used. It's funereal music. It's a kind of a music that's sung, and there's a whole ritual that goes along with it when somebody passes away.
Esa esencia la traemos desde África. Desde África se hace alusión con el gospel a los muertos. Cada vez que una persona se muere, se le canta para que pueda llegar a la gloria.
So it's a form of music that serves a function very similar to gospel in the sense that it's a ritual that we go through so that someone can pass to heaven.
El alabado es dedicado a los muertos adultos. Y tenemos otra tradición que es el gualí, que es para los niños.
The difference between alabao and gualí, there are two different forms. Alabao is a type of music that is sung when somebody who's an elder person passes away. And there's another form called gualí, which is used when a small child or a baby passes away.
¿Quiénes cantan gospel aquí?
Anybody here sing gospel?
Tiene mucha relación lo que van a escuchar.
So it's got a lot in common with gospel, and obviously it comes from the same root. And I think we can draw it back to the spirituals that happens here in the American South, and you'll hear the relationship.
Gospel, Africa, Estados Unidos, alabado, Colombia, Chocó.
To heaven. And so it's a little bit more of a feeling time.
So we're going to sing a song, like a playful song, a game type of song called El Alani.
Yeah.
Bueno, entonces ahora vamos a mirar lo que es el curulao. Curulao también parte de esa versión del alabado.
So now we're going to move on to the rhythm called curulao, and it's another one that's got, it's sort of a cousin of alabao. It has some elements that we just heard in this rhythm.
Sí. El curulao se nace cuando, especialmente en, porque los pueblos en la costa pacífica son ribereños, o sea, son en río prácticamente todos. Y para cuando iban canaleteando, las mujeres y los hombres.
So a lot of the communities that you find in the Pacific region in Choco are founded on rivers. So as you move through these rivers, you see different pueblos, and they all interpret some of these rhythms differently. And the curulao is kind of a courtship music and dance.
Entonces iban en la canoa, iban cantando y contestaban y se repetían frases que les salían.
So as people travel along, because it's a lot like water taxis. People travel through these communities in canoes, and they're just kind of singing. And so we know that here in a lot of African American music, we have call and response, right? We have the same thing in Afro-Colombian music, especially in curulao. So you might have someone in a canoe, like singing a verse, and people from the pueblo might sing back a chorus.
Tenemos al WhatsApp. WhatsApp es ese instrumento que le da una tonalidad sabrosa. Ahí lo tenemos. Tócalo, Jeff.
So, again, going with the instruments that we feature in curulao, starting with, this is called WhatsApp. And there are different types of WhatsApp. There's another one that's made of metal that has a different sound. This is made of wood, local wood. ¿Cómo se llama? Palo.
Guadua,
sí. Guadua. So it's something like bamboo, and it's played, there's a lot of different ways to play this. Very much like there's a ton of these different kinds of things in Africa that are used, you know, I'm sure we've all seen.
Tenemos también tambora hembra y tambor macho.
So this is an interesting thing about the curulao and Afro-Colombian music. We have a feminine and a masculine drum, and a lot of times they're used with call and response as well, just like vocal.
Tenemos cununo hembra, cununo macho, que también hacen parte del conjunto musical del curulao. Claro,
So with the cununo, which is a lot like a conga type of a drum, you have a masculine sounding one and a feminine sounding one, and the call and response is used, they play different rhythms within the cununo.
Ah, sí, llamado respuesta. Y tenemos la madre de los instrumentos, que se llama la marimba.
So this is the mother, yeah, the real bassist.
El piano de la selva, sí.
Yeah, this only, the nickname for it is the piano of the jungle. The marimba, right here in the top center. The marimba, it's a lot like a xylophone, but like with, again, local woods. So out of the jungle, they use all local materials to build all these instruments that you've seen. And the marimba is what really gives the flavor and essence to the curulao.
El curulao también se convierte en danza. Además de ser música con instrumentos, es danza, que ahorita vamos a conocer un poquito.
So apart from being just a musical form or a genre, curulao includes dance interpretation. It's a big, big part of curulao, and momentarily we're going to learn how to do it.
Bueno, entonces, escuchemos un poco cómo suena el curulao.
So here's a traditional curulao.
¿Cuántas son las cantadoras?
¡Soy yo!
Thank you.
Thank you very much for being here. And we, if you have any questions, we'd love to answer them or open up some kind of dialogue. Anything yet? Curious comments?
I have a request. Can my man? Can we? You spittle it. Can you? Can you rap a little bit? Give us a rap. Yeah, because we have a hip hop artist up there too. He wants to hear. He's an MC as well. Vamos. Come on, man. Get DC, man.
Sonido boom. De cualquier malla sale un rato.
Que buscaba mi raza pura, mi negrura, en el sentido de la cultura, en el sentencia africana, donde toditos somos pana, es el corrido del vecino, del primo de la hermana, unidos en una fiesta, allá en mi tierra chocuana.
Rand, they wanted you to rap with them.
If you claim MC, you gotta.
Yeah, come on, man. DC hip hop, man.
Anybody else have a question or anything they want to ask? In the meantime.
You're set up.
En que si en Colombia hay influencia de esos lugares.
La música de ustedes.
Sí hay mucha influencia en Colombia. A veces llega música de República Dominicana, de Puerto Rico, como el reggaetón, la salsa, todas esas cosas, la bachata. Y también en Colombia cogen algunos de estos ritmos y están también evolucionando cosas. Ok, dale ritmo al...
¿Qué significa ser el bueno, primero que todo, gracias por hacer patria, porque yo soy colombiana. ¿Qué significa ser embajadores de la música afro ante el mundo entero para ustedes?
Para nosotros es un gran orgullo, porque no es fácil. No es fácil hacer música y llegar a Washington a cantar. Entonces, para nosotros es un gran orgullo porque es algo que llevamos en las venas, en el corazón, en la sangre. Y cuando lo podemos expresar, y más de esta manera tan, pues que es pedagógica, que no es solo cantar y venir a cantar, sino que estamos dejando un granito de arena en un país que no es nuestro, entre comillas. Entonces, sí, es... colocar a Colombia, al Chocó, nuestra raza, nuestra gente en lo más alto que podemos.
Is everyone Spanish speaking here? Who does not? Okay. So the question was, can you repeat your question?
It's what does it mean to be representative of Afro-Colombian music on a world stage?
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
suffer. She said that it was something that to be very proud of, to be able to bring the Afro-Colombian music here to a place that's not their country, and to bring they represent Chocó as well, which is a smaller region there, to bring Chocó, to bring their blood, to bring their blackness here, and to share that is a moment of pride for them.
And to do it in a unique format like this, not just to come up and do a concert for a bunch of people, but to have this opportunity to expand on some of these issues.
All right. Right there.
So we have a special collaboration coming up from
put it into his days. I got one reason for it, never write to me when I'm going into my day. That ain't that big. Kids ain't funny, that's left with the phone, don't play. And you can run around so high. People got pretty happy to waste blood. Come front with a fake ass, I hear the bang and pop. Tips, chops. I call it poop, put it back. Hope you don't know, hit you with a slam that you maintain. But race gotta take the pain, hope against the rain, and remain in the same frame. Won't even know, I'm so open up shop, run a clock, double up, so I'm gone. Tell me, all right.